Inside the Music with saxophonist Will Donato and co-host Jack Cohen. We bring you renowned recording artists and musical guests from around the globe, featuring live in-studio performances from our very special guests. We broadcast live from the LA Talk Radio studios the first and third Saturdays of each month in stunning HD video. Thank you for tuning in to Inside the Music.
Hot.
Good morning, everyone. I'm saxophonist Will Donato, cancer survivor, lover of life, hanging out with my buddies who just plain love music, and I'm excited for this show. I love prepping for it because it's my friend and dear artist, Darryl Williams. Plus, we have a very good-looking gallery. We have the lovely Violet is here. I thought she was a model, Jack, that you hired for our show, and then I realized she's with Darryl Williams. Dang it.
What would you expect?
I know. I thought you finally hired a model for us, for the show. So anyway, this is a long conversation show, and this is our format of our new Power Hour, and we're really excited. We can finally just really dig in, and I'm not even sure what episode this is, but we've done a lot of shows.
I think this is episode 17.
I'm very proud of that.
Yeah.
Awesome.
And I see Jack Cohen's hands.
Oh, yes. And we're live on Facebook. And I better make a quick adjustment.
Yeah. So, everybody out there, you can go to Darryl Williams 1 or Darryl Williams 2.
That's right.
Because there's no Facebook page that could hold Darryl Williams. And
that's a fact.
No one. Yeah. Will Donato's page, Jack Cohen's page, or Mikey Adam Cohen's page, and watch today's show on Facebook Live. So.
Right.
This is something new we're doing just this week for Darryl Williams. Now, Will, so
for me?
Yeah. So an unknown fact is Darryl Williams was the first show in our new studio.
That's right.
2 years ago.
I saw that. I watched a little bit of it.
And
did Darryl you watch when the music stopped and everything? And everything shut down.
We didn't need to go there.
Yeah.
And we call that a wardrobe malfunction.
Yeah. Darryl is a good luck for us. So this is our first Power Hour show.
Okay.
We're experimenting with a 1 hour show.
So together. I'm a guinea pig now.
You were last time.
That's right.
You were last time.
You know what, though?
You're going to call your family, your friends to be the guinea pig. So that's right.
Because the people want to know.
Yeah.
People want to know.
And I had the pleasure of being at one of Darryl's killer residence gigs. And I loved at the end of the night going out in the patio. And this handsome dude pulled me aside and says, I do a show too. I'm thinking, you got a show too? And he goes, yeah, stand right there. And then it was so organic and cool. But just being on that patio with people enjoying life, folks just loving life, and then Darryl had the wherewithal just to...
By the way, happy birthday.
Yes.
Man.
Thank you.
Happy birthday.
Thank you. I just turned 29. So, you know.
I heard the Pub and Grub. It was like standing room only. The Pub and Grub, for those of you who don't know, is... This young man here has developed an amazing following in the Inland Empire, San Diego, Southern California, for his jam. And the jam...
He's a Goodwill ambassador for music.
He's a great Goodwill ambassador for music. The jam is he has seasoned artists come there and jam and play. Mm-hmm. And then up-and-coming people that want to be a professional musician come and play. And then during the jam... which is an eclectic mix of all kinds of really talented people. Darryl comes out with his DWTV.
That's right.
And DWTV, for those of you who don't know.
Usually at 9:30.
I'm on it religiously. I'm on it religiously because, you know what, I'm one of those people that want to know. And you know, Darryl,
the people
want to know. They want to know. So if you want to know, tune in at 9:30 on Darryl Williams' page.
Right.
And go to Facebook Live and watch DWTV.
It's a good time, always.
It's always a good time.
And also for our other bass players that are trying to coattail on Darryl Williams, the only taglines that are left now are, what you talking about? People want to know is taken. It's copyrighted.
Okay, Will.
So come up with your own tagline.
Will, I need to pick on you for a minute.
I don't mind it.
Okay. First of all, both of you guys played the Intervision Jam on Sunday night.
That was fun.
Yeah.
Had the opportunity of playing.
He's so busy. I'm already on to Catalina now.
That was the fifth annual Intervision Jam.
You know what? I am seasoned enough to know it ain't all about me. And when I showed up and I saw Big Shot, Other Big Shot, and Hans Vermeulen Solo, Han Solo.
Well, Will, it kind of was about you, because you probably played as a front man on more songs than anybody else.
Well, actually, I got double duty because a couple of guys couldn't make it on the horns. But, man, you know what? When you pass that breaking artist stage and you show up and you see Tony Moore, Darryl Williams, and Hans, it don't matter what's going to happen.
So
it's awesome.
Again, it was so damn good.
It was a great time.
It was so good.
Again, for our audience, the last week was NAMM, which is the international show for music merchandisers who have guitars like that stunning bass that
and
Darryl
the new
Williams
one
has.
I just got.
Oh, I love
I just
that.
Got last week.
That's so
he'll
awesome.
Be breaking that out.
Darryl, your endorsers are who?
Carvin Kiesel. So that's a shout out to Mark and Jeff Kiesel. Thank you guys for everything.
Thank you.
You guys make some incredible instruments.
So people like Darryl can go there and see all the latest and greatest gear.
There was a lot of stuff to see.
People from all over the world. Musicians come from all over the world. It's really an unbelievable experience. We talked about it last week.
You know what's amazing? Can I say something?
Yes, you can.
I remember years ago when I used to go to say, 15 years ago, you know, I used to just want to walk in, or even longer than that, and just play these different basses. And
when you were 20 years old?
Yeah.
Yes.
I used to want to play on all these different basses and things like that. So now I see all these young guys who all, it's almost like the, you know, NAMM show chops, basically, because you get these young guys who really don't do gigs.
Yeah.
They just practice all year for the NAMM show.
Really? I want to hear this.
And they play some blazing, incredible stuff, but then you say, hey, so what are you doing? Oh, nothing. Just practicing. If you hear of anything, Will.
I have my standard NAMM joke, and I'm not proud of it. I'll say here on the radio. I always email a friend that when I'm headed to NAMM, I go, I just found out if you're a working musician, you can't go to NAMM.
Hey, I try to get in and out.
So, Will, going back to you. Well, first of all, we didn't finish this, but Will is signed to Intervision Records. So the jam we're talking about is there are some lot of jams going on during NAMM because all the musicians are here. Right. Legere has a jam. Intervision has a jam on Sunday night. And all their artists come and sponsors. This is the fifth annual. And Will pretty much is the flagship and Blake Aaron the flagship artist on Intervision. So that's what the jam was, to feature their artists. And then local then musicians that were here for NAMM could join in at the end and play, right?
Which I like that. You know what? As much as we joke about NAMM, I loved it that we had a killing band as a part of that project. Just knowing your band is stunning. And we had a lot of good musicians this year come in.
Yeah.
Sometimes you don't know what you get. You know, you've got an interesting assortment of people who just want to see and be seen, which is good. But I really love the people that came in, and there were a lot of them. And knowing that we've got, you know, this band quality there, I like the jam. And it was nice that they can play.
Okay, so
that's the most saxophone players I've ever seen there.
I know.
So Will, your co-host, me.
Yes.
I had a jam.
I know. You know.
And your jam killed our jam.
I had a jam. Not to say I'm deserving of a jam.
Okay, where was your jam? But,
and he arranged the whole thing.
So,
and I thought that was very cool that you did that. You're following the Darryl Williams template.
Selena Albright.
Promoting and curating.
Selena Albright played at the Mediterranean,
right,
which you've played at before yourself. So
that's a shout out to
Snap. Yeah.
Snap DeVall.
I can't say enough about Duvel Chase.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Here's a young man going for it.
Like, yes, he is.
He's had Julian Vaughn. He has Phil Denny coming up. Lynn Roundtree. Darryl's played there. Will's played there. Yeah. And, Chase. Hey, I'm ecstatic because in San Diego, our town, Darryl Williams' town, too, we have a jazz club, a real jazz club. And people are turning out, and this guy's putting it all on the line for San Diegans. Thank you, Duvel.
Thank you. Right on.
And keep it going. So I said to Snap, his nickname, Snap, dude, it's NAMM. Why don't we do a NAMM jam right here, man? Let's do it.
That's so clever.
So I gathered up. Darryl, you know I brought by your jam a couple of young people from time to time.
Yeah.
So if you remember Wakana from Japan.
Of course.
She has a new album out that's already number 25 on smoothjazz.com.
Okay, awesome.
Yeah. And she played, killed it. And then Daniel Chia, who you just had out.
Of course.
Yeah, he's from Singapore. So we have an international
jam.
We do. Jay White.
Yep.
And Chase Huna.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
And Chase Huna was the host.
That we're getting a
killed it. Killed it.
We're getting a message. People want to call in and they want to know the number to call in. Do you have it?
Are you putting pressure on me right now?
No.
818.
But you can't distract from this artist here. We had a lot of questions. This man is content rich.
570-5085.
Got that, if people? Anybody would like to call in, you know, like, just keep ringing because I'm not going to interrupt a meaningful conversation at the time. But yes, we like call-ins. Okay, so now the jam, we had... Probably 150 people there.
That's great you did that.
It was huge.
Wow.
Huge. Okay. Well, that was Selena played afterwards.
Right. Okay.
Very successful. Right. So we're coming to get you.
Miss Selena's awesome.
She's awesome,
right? She is.
She had Keita Matsuno on guitar.
The two of them. They're
spectacular. So now, Will Donato, I'm going to pick on you for a minute.
I don't mind.
Okay. So, Will, I don't know if you know this, but you have a new single coming out.
Oh, yes, I do.
Gravitas. Now, I'm going to give people a little background on this. Will came out with an album a few months ago called Supersonic.
Supersonic.
First single.
Supersonic.
And Darryl, you played some tunes, right?
I played on two songs.
He played a reggae tune that just was so killer, and he just came in and...
Classic tune, too. Steps Ahead.
And JJ played on that, too, right?
Yeah.
JJ Santovarino.
And I already talked to Darryl's people, and he's playing on my new CD, and I'm almost ready to tell you the title, but I'm not yet, because I don't want...
Okay.
You don't want to give it away.
So Will's new single...
It's Here to Stay, too. And that was then, too.
So...
And please tell me that's not taken. I thought about this all night.
By the way, that's Darryl Williams' hot single, it's Billboard hot Top 10 tune. Anyway, dude, you made me give up.
You're talking about the single, which is nice of you, because I said you didn't have to because we have Darryl Williams here.
Yeah, Will's doing something unprecedented here. The Gravitas, as it appears on the album, is a killer tune, really good. But Will's thinking, Will and I were talking about this, you know, if you're going to go to radio, you got to really bring it. And sometimes when you do a cut for an album, a full, you know, like 5-minute cut, and you edit it, it doesn't necessarily is not a good radio tune. So this guy right here, which I haven't heard of anybody doing, took Gravitas, went to Mr. Paul Brown down the street, mm-hmm. two-time Grammy Award winner, producer, and had him remix the tune.
Okay.
This tune is so killer. And
it is.
Another thing, the world premiere of Gravitas is right here today.
And the world premiere in Europe is Monday with Richard Edwards.
So there you go. So we're not going to wait any longer. We're going to play Gravitas. But I'd like to interject right here, and then I'm going to have Will introduce it. I've listened to the song as I have yours, Darryl. Last night, I just couldn't stop listening to either one of your tunes. The music was that good.
Yeah, your new record is... I listened to it on the way over. I just kind of went back and forth, and I actually had a chance, because I live in Egypt, so I actually got to listen to That Was Then, even. Because yeah. I love Costa Rica.
Thank you.
Oh.
Thank you. I wrote that for my wife, you know, right?
Mm-hmm. I know. Mm-hmm. That's Miss Costa Rica 2018.
That's right
there.
Okay, so,
And 19.
Well, one observation is, which you can talk about when you intro the song, is when I was listening to it, I felt like a band was playing right there in my living room.
That's the
magic
of Paul Brown.
I don't know what you did, but it was killer. It was so the dynamic range was incredible. It sounded like the drummer was right there. Now, can you intro your song?
You know, typically when... artists like myself and Darryl do a radio edit, pretty much we're just trimming something already existing to make it fit like 3 minutes, 40 seconds, 3 minutes, 30 seconds. Or we might take out an elongated solo. So I loved the way my record was mixed. I did it on purpose. I wanted a few instruments, and I wanted it to have a experience like you're going live, because I really wanted to deliver what I deliver at my live shows, which is these guys here. I don't have the garden weasel of Flobee. I don't have plastic apples on my tracks. I have Darryl Williams, Tony, Tatang, me, and that's it. And I love the technology that we have, and we can all sit there and add all kinds of sample libraries, but I didn't want that on this record. So I was very happy with my final mixes, and it was nice and dry, and good dry. And then I had a chance, Paul wanted to use a groove off my album, and he said very nicely, what can I do for you? I said, well, how about a mix? I said, great. You know, Paul Brown, yes. And
He have like 60 to 70 Billboard hits. Number ones.
Yes.
Yeah.
So because we keep this show real, my wife says, don't micromanage him. Don't try to get your concept. Don't propel that piano thing that you've been going on and about and the awesome bass player driver. Let the man do his thing. Can I just negotiate a little bit? Don't micromanage Paul. So Paul brought in his elements. We even actually put acoustic or electric piano on and pads and strings. And I mean, it's just the mojo. He brings his mojo in, and I love it. But to already be happy with your mix, like if Darryl took his mixes and he's like, I love Here to Stay, but Umberto Gatica or someone goes, can I do something with the song? Sure.
So, Will, you have an international
cast on this one.
Yeah, can you tell
us? I've got a friend of mine from Germany on bass who plays a lot of those Christian Bosner gigs in Spain and Portugal and Germany. His name is Gunter Ausbecht. He's a funny guy. I love him dearly. He looks just like John Candy, big rosy cheeks. And he says to me when I first meet him, when you look like me, you've got to be funky. He's just rosy cheeks.
And
he goes, when you look like me, you've got to be funky. Well, I hear you. And I have Christian Pozak from France, who's a real musical drummer.
I like him.
I just love him. He really thinks out of the box.
With Cirque du Soleil.
Yeah, and he's done a lot of road work. And he's not in town much, but we're really good friends. And I met him when he didn't speak English very well. And he used to say to me, his English was really funny. And he would say, I just did a frickin' gig. And Eddie and I said, what? I did a frickin' gig. He was trying to say an African gig. The syllables and the emphasis was really wild. It was just so funny. But his sense of humor for a guy who just learned English like 18, 20 years ago, when he first came, was amazing. But he played drums, and then Mike Whitaker from Nashville played the Rhodes and the pads, and he's a beast.
Yes, he is. Mm-hmm.
And you know what? For guys like us that are producing out of our homes, he delivers it the frickin' next day and everything. And, you know, usually all of us are conscientious, but, you know, Darryl does, you know, like we have a work ethic. We do want to get to it. But it's like, well, how much sleep don't I want this week to keep my reputation? But, you know, Mike delivered the next day. And what that means, folks, is basically we send our tracks through web sharing to another location, and other artists take our tracks and add their artistry to it.
Through the miracle of computers
and
the internet.
I did not drive on my previous album. I did not leave my house on Universal Groove. And I thought, wow. And I can remember the days going up like Steve Reed's studio every day. And it was just so surreal not to leave my home in Egypt, a.k.a. Palm Springs.
Well, let's hear it. Okay.
Well, thank you. Now, Darryl Williams told me when I'm being interviewed on my show, he's going to come in and play his new cut on my time as well. So, and that's fine.
When you're on DWT.
Hey, I can't wait to hear it. I can't wait to hear it.
You know what? It's the magic of Paul Brown. It's just like that.
Oh. Okay, Will, because the people want to know. Do they, Darryl?
They absolutely want to know.
Okay, so here we go.
Let's see what they're saying on Facebook.
That tagline is...
killer.
Thank you, Jack, for debuting.
I love that song. World premiere. And, Will, that was stunning. I mean, the drums were so crisp. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's a great mix.
I love the way it was tracked and built. And I had my dear buddies over at the studio in Palm Desert for years. When you live out in the desert, you got to trek to L.A., and it's always 2.5 hours to get to L.A., and you come back. And it's just, I couldn't
find it. Well, it's 5 hours, 2.5 hours up, 2.5 hours.
Yeah, I'm sorry, 5 hour round trip. But to have a studio, I literally can go, Don, what are you doing this morning? And just get a coffee for him, and we are in there. Plus, we're good friends, but we don't chit-chat a lot. I'm literally, like, so focused when I get in there. I'm behind the mic in about 15 minutes. And when I had my All-Stars come over, I'm thinking, oh, these guys just came from Lorber's studio, and they came from probably Capitol. I don't know if they're going to like my little Palm Desert studio. And they just came in and go,
it's great, man.
He's really, that guy's in it to
and
win it.
And you know what, also, the engineers.
It's a sweetheart. It's,
you know, that always makes the studio, because if they have great ears and they hear things, that makes it, it doesn't matter if they have all this great stuff and they can't hear anything, you know.
He's kind of like a Paul. He's done live, so much live work and so much live mixing and recording that he just feels at home putting out fires. But I also got a kick out of, because a lot of people in the desert don't have the access. They're just doing stuff locally in little indie bands. And I just loved his jaw dropped every time one of these guys left. I just felt really good about it. Like, wow.
Will lives in the Coachella Valley, and the studio's in India, or is it?
It's actually in Palm Desert. It's called Gem Studios.
Yeah, in Palm Desert. And, you know, there's not a, I mean, obviously, yeah, L.A. is where it's happening. There's like a million studios in L.A., but Will's lucky enough to have a studio like, you know, 10 minutes from his house, probably.
It feels like it's mine, because if he's not busy, I can just go over there and hang out all day. And just a great guy. And it just, I was so thrilling that he just loves the artistry of these guys. And for like, so if I, for like 2.5 days after like someone like Darryl leaves, we're just working along. He goes, man, that Darryl. I'm like, well, okay, that's great. Now we're on this guy now. That Roberto Valley, man. But it makes you feel good. It's not the typical LA guy. I just had, you know, Miroslav Vichis in here last week, and Jocko, and I don't know, who's this guy?
You know, Will, I'm really excited about this guy right here. I wanted to give a little intro myself. Darryl, to me, is one of the people I most respect in the industry, because you will never hear a bad word about this guy. If anything, everything is totally positive. Yes. Mm-hmm. No matter what. He's always prepared. He is the consummate sideman. I'd like to see him come up front a little bit more myself. But another thing I want to thank you for, Darryl, and Tony Moore as well. These two guys took us under, you know, I was showing up at Spagatini right and left, taking photos, not really any kind of agenda or anything. And these guys took us under their wing, made us feel like family, like you know, it was home. And it was always good looking up and seeing Darryl and Tony back there. I want to thank you for that, Darryl, because I really appreciate how you treated us from day one.
I have to
really
add something to that,
thank
too.
You, and I appreciate you guys as well.
Thank you.
I want to add something to it, too, because something that when you're as busy as Darryl is, you'll never hear it. But if I'm on the road and you just inherit a house band because of time and space and budgets, I want him to know also, if I'm hanging out with someone like a Tim George in Florida, and there we are, it's just nice to hear them talking about Darryl. Mm-hmm. Like, he's right here.
Hey, those Florida
and they're
guys
way
are
out there.
Yeah.
And they'll just say, oh, Darryl. And it almost feels like I'm home, because some guy that's in Connecticut, oh, that Darryl's great. Even the guy in Germany, the folks in Europe.
He's like, who is Darryl? No.
the guys that are in it to win it in Europe, they really know things going on. And it's just charming. It's like, you know, stuff that we look at routine. Oh, I'm just going to Spags, but I got a killer band, Darryl Williams. And I can almost hear like that record scratch. So this guy in Germany is like, Darryl Williams will be there? And he even knew Mike Whitaker from Nashville. But those guys, I guess they're like we were when we used to pour over liner notes and look at people and just.
Someone foreign to us, every time they'll say, God, we have an incredible band. And they'll always talk about you, like you're a part of it.
And guys that are routing, they know if it says Darryl and Tony, they can go, okay, cool. No flat tires. We got Mitch Lewis.
And for those of you who don't know, Darryl is probably the most prolific bass sideman in the LA area, and there's a lot of good ones.
Yes,
there are a lot of good ones. Yeah. But Darryl's pretty much the first call guy. You'll see him with Huge Groove on tour. You'll see him with Mike Linkton on tour. He's playing with Kim Waters right now at Catalina.
Yep. You see him playing
for
on
what,
the Dave
three
Cruise.
Nights? Or?
Yeah, this is the last night tonight.
Yeah,
I think the show's 8:30 to 10. So
yeah, so
8:30 to 10, Catalina folks.
You folks in the LA area, come down to Catalina Club tonight and see the amazing Kim Waters.
He is amazing.
He
elegant.
Is amazing.
Elegant, classy man.
Yeah, yeah, and Darryl Williams. And the list of people he plays with, you know, Peter White, Dave Cause. He's been on the Dave Cause cruise. How many years have you been on there now?
I think this is year four for me.
Year four on the main stage. Mm-hmm. When you play on the Dave Cause cruise, you're basically playing with a who's who, not just of the contemporary jazz world, but the music world in general.
R&B as well.
Yeah, R&B and, you know, just, you know, Michael McDonald. All kinds of people, you know, like, I'll turn it over to you with the people.
Well, that's
you
a
play.
Great cruise to be on. I mean, it's a lot of work, but it's a lot of fun, and we're all treated very well. Shout out to Dave Cause for being the best.
Yes, Dave.
Yes, he treats us, you know, really well. You know, we work hard, but it's a lot of fun.
Who have really you played is. With there where you looked up and you go, I can't believe I'm playing with this person?
Man, well. There's been so many. Jonathan Butler, of course. I've never worked with him, and you know, until last year. That was incredible.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
yeah. Now the people tell me he changes his show every time, like
no,
on the fly.
Oh well, you have to watch. You have to listen, but that's part of like a call and response thing. You just have to, you know, keep your eyes and ears open and just be prepared for you know wherever he wants to go, you know. And Gerald Albright, although I have worked with him before. That was incredible. That was, you know, incredible.
Great guy.
All the guys were incredible on the cruise. Everybody, you know.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah,
Michael Linkton, yeah. Mindy, of course.
Yeah.
And of course, Peter White.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Of course, Peter White.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know what? Again, when you, if you're just joining us, we have the amazing Darryl Williams. And I don't just say that flippantly. There's so many layers to this man's artistry, from curating people's careers, recording, front man, and just great artistry in motion. Time flies when you have someone like Darryl. We literally basically are 30 minutes into this show, but you've got such a great bio with a real trajectory and an informed point of view. But I did notice something that's really interesting. Mm-hmm. You basically, on your bio, it says you started bass at 13, but mm-hmm. when you are literally playing in clubs 2 years later, I feel like were your folks musical, or were you diddling around with piano at six? Did you you can't just turn the switch on like that? That's amazing.
Well, what happened is, you know, I did leave one thing out. My first instrument was actually the cello.
Oh.
Okay, so I was already
no
musically,
way.
Yeah.
Wow.
So I was
no
already
way.
You know musically inclined before I got my first bass. But also my brother's a guitar player. He's a great guitar player. So that was, you know, we kind of learned together.
How the
quickly.
Heck did you end up being on cello?
You know, to be honest, I was looking for an easy A. You know, I was looking for an easy A. So I'm thinking,
we've people, been there.
Cello is awesome. It's really like.
Well, no, I didn't have a choice really because there were four string bass players. You know, I was a little late to class. So, I mean,
and,
the first
year. Are we talking elementary now?
No, seventh grade.
Okay, and that seventh grade usually means like 12, right?
Right. So. I walk in, and I was not about to play the violin.
And that's junior high now.
Right.
Elementary is behind you.
Right. I was not about to play the violin.
No.
And then
it's complicated.
No viola. No way. No violin. No viola. So I see the cello, and I'm like, well, it's kind of close to that big, you know,
that's
instrument.
That's hilarious.
So I'll play that then.
That's so funny.
Yeah, so.
Now, did you do the classical thing first?
I was in orchestra.
Wow.
Wow. Yeah. And, you know, it's hard to describe because I played classical clarinet. Mm-hmm. When you're sitting in the middle of an orchestra and those folks are sawing away, that's kind of like being in a Bose headphone. It's like, it's kind of it's kind of a neat sound.
Yeah, it really is. But the thing that's interesting is after the first semester, the teacher walks up to me and says, "You know what? You know you have a natural ability to play this instrument. You should take it home and practice." And I'm thinking, and at this time, I was living in South Central Los Angeles.
Oh, no.
Okay. Yeah. I'm going to walk down the street.
With a cello case.
With a cello. I don't think so.
No.
So I was like, oh, yeah, yeah, sure.
It doesn't really scream badass.
So I was like, yeah, sure, man. I'll get with you on that. Yeah, sure.
I think this is awesome, dude. Yeah. This is great.
Yeah, man.
See, this doesn't come off the page.
That's nice.
Wow.
Now, you know, I didn't find a need to put that.
Could you pick up a cello if Violet bought you one and just something to...
No. A string bass, I could. I could a bow on a string bass. But
so, wow. So how'd you end up playing bass now?
Well, we moved to San Diego.
Yeah.
Because, you know, L.A. was getting real dangerous at that time. Oh. You know, it was kind of the Boys in the Hood era.
Right.
Although way before the movie, but it was kind of like how it was.
Wow.
Or even like Minister Society. Society. Right.
Yeah. And what did mom and pops do? What kind of?
Mom worked for Pacific Bell.
Oh, wow.
At the time. But my mom is a great singer.
So
she can really sing.
She was behind the arts. She was definitely not, you should do something practical. She definitely was not, she was definitely on the team of you looking at a musical instrument.
Oh, yeah, she was definitely supportive. But here's the thing. I remember my brother and I used to rehearse in the room, and my mom used to come and close the door. We were in there rehearsing, trying to learn how to play.
And so he's playing guitar, you're playing bass.
Yeah. That's funny. And also my cousin was playing drums. So, you know, my mom used to come and close the door.
So you guys had your own little band thing going there.
Yeah, we were, you know, actually rehearsing in the house. We kind of converted into our own, like, rehearsal studio.
And this is 12 and 13-ish, 14-ish?
Yeah.
And what were you kind of, what were you being influenced by? What were you trying to do at that time?
Prince, Cameo was my favorite group at the time.
Wow.
Prince, Cameo, The Time.
So cool.
All that stuff. And, you know, all the R&B stuff that was on the radio, too. We
not jazz yet-ish.
So would you guys play like jazz, a...
Not quite yet.
Would you guys play like a record or something and then play to it? Or
Well, we sit down there and like learn songs beforehand. Like, hey, let's learn this song, let's learn that song, and let's, you know, rehearse tomorrow. So we'd get together the next day and we'd try to play these songs. A lot of times they were completely wrong, but, you know, we'd play them anyway. So my mom used to come close the door. So this went on for about a year. And then she finally, one time I still remember specifically when she didn't close the door.
Then you knew you had
it. So I was thinking, we must sound pretty good then. We must be getting better. She didn't close the door on us.
So now it's you're like 15. People are starting to ask you to play with them in clubs.
Mm-hmm.
Is that when Shirley Caesar happened-ish or all at the same time?
Well, here's what happened with that. I had a teacher at Morris High School who was a choir director at San Diego State. And he says to me, and I'll tell you something funny about that. Okay, he says to me, hey, I have this gig, and I want you to play bass with Shirley Caesar. And I'm like, oh, yeah, great, man. So I did the gig.
Did you know who she was at the time?
Of course.
Yeah.
She's a legend. She was a legend then.
Right.
So I did the gig. The gig was great.
Were you nervous about playing?
Nah, I never really had, you know, stage fright or anything with playing with anybody. But the crazy thing about it is that was my introduction into the music industry because the teacher... I hope he's listening right now. He never paid me. He never paid me or the drummer for the gig. We never got paid for the gig.
Let's see what you're
listening.
Let's see, that was 1987.
I don't know. We never got paid for the gig.
Darryl, with compound interest, you could add on to your house.
Yeah. That was my introduction to the music business. We never got paid.
Aww. Well, in some ways, you might have gotten paid in the experience.
The experience was great. You know, she was incredible, of course.
Now, did you tour with her?
No.
Because you left high school and you did a 4-month tour.
Of Japan.
Oh, wow.
With the same band that I grew up playing with.
Oh.
Yeah, we went to Japan
How'd that happen, Darryl?
Well, there was an agent in San Diego named Steve Titus. What's up, Steve Titus? He's probably watching this. He came over and asked us, hey, man, you guys are exactly what they're looking for. You guys are a young band. You guys sound great. You do all these dance moves. Would you like to go to Japan? And we said, sure, yeah. So we ended up going. We were there unchaperoned for 4 months.
And how old are you guys?
I was 18. Wow. 18, almost 19. I turned 19 over.
Violet, sir, you may want to give the edited version of this.
Hey, well, I will do that.
Yeah.
But, you know, that was our, you know, we were unchaperoned, so we had a great 4 months.
That's when you used to perform in a kimono, right?
No, but you know what? We played from 10 o'clock at night to, I think, 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning.
Do you feel that you really understood what it was like to be a professional musician at that point?
Well, we were already in clubs at the time.
Yeah.
You know, so
San
we were
Diego.
Already doing gigs in San Diego and stuff, so... Yeah, that was
great. When did you first think that I could be a professional musician? When did that come about?
I think when we went to Japan.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, you came back and decided to go to San Diego State, mm-hmm. and you studied with Gunnar Biggs.
Yes.
And Rick Helser.
Incredible piano player.
Piano player. Mm-hmm. I looked up Gunnar, and it just seemed like a cool dude.
He's very cool.
Double bass.
He grew up with Nathan East.
Wow.
Yeah.
Now, so you're coming back from Japan, turbocharged with pop and R&B. Mm-hmm. Were you slightly transitioning to listening to jazz a little bit?
I was already listening, even before we went to Japan.
And who were you listening to when you were making that? Who caught your ear like,
The main guy at that time was Marcus Miller, so I listened to everything he played on. And it was Miles Davis at the time, and David Sanborn, of course.
Yeah.
We Want Miles was way before Tutu. I think that was like 1987-ish?
Oh, no, 88.
No, like late 70s.
Really?
Wow. We Want Miles. That was his, like, I think that was his return album.
Oh,
and then The Man with the Horn, that was Marcus playing on that, too. So
Bill Evans on sax.
Exactly.
So he was your biggest influence, Marcus Miller?
Well, Louis Johnson.
Yeah.
Originally, but then, and you know, all the bass players from Cameo and all that stuff. I was listening to all that stuff, so at an early age.
Now, when you started at San Diego State, mm-hmm. and you had Gunner there and Rick, is that when you started looking and seeing like Magnuson in L.A. and Cecil McBee?
Well,
and Marshall Hawkins,
because
I think that's really admirable. That I always wonder why people in L.A. When I was a kid, I thought I could look up Tom Scott in the Musicians Local 47. Hi, Tom. I've got a lot of pimples, but could you take an hour? I thought, wow, you can just call anybody up and they'll...
You know, I left somebody out. I also studied with Carol Kay.
No, you did not.
The great bassist, Carol Kay.
She's the lady that was on every TV.
She was
thing.
On the Beach Boys records. I mean, at the time, I believe she was a member of the Wrecking Crew, right?
Wrecking Crew.
The Wrecking Crew. They played on everything.
Tedesco.
All the movie scores and everything.
So who is most influential for your style of playing today of all the people that
Of all the bass players in general?
Yeah, people that mentored you or you.
Well, there's a lot of guys. Cecil McBee Jr., of course, Marcus Miller, Stanley Clark, Victor Wooten, Jaco Pastorius, Abraham Laborio. I mean, there's a long list of guys. I mean, I could go on and on. Even some guys that I still watch now, Nathaniel Phillips. I was a big fan of his.
Yeah.
You know, so, yeah.
So you did the San Diego thing. Mm-hmm. Why did you decide to go to Vegas in 97? Did you feel like you kind of hit your...
No, it was a crazy thing. I was in Las Vegas with my wife, and I met a piano player up there. And I was just talking to him. We just, you know, had a conversation. You know, I explained to him, you know, what I was doing in San Diego. And he knew most of the musicians I was working with. So 2 weeks later, he called me and said, I need a bass player in 2 weeks.
And was this really? Clint Holmes gigs? Or
no, this is before Clint.
That looked like a cool gig with him.
Clint's incredible,
Because he looked like he was just in it to win it and a real deal dude waiting to
Clint, he's actually probably like the most underrated artist that I've ever worked
with. This is a Vegas artist, yeah.
Yeah, but he's you know, he's international. You know, he had a number two hit in the 70s. It was called Playground in My Mind.
It's so funny.
Remember that song? My name is Michael, I've got a nickel. Well,
I
like you didn't hear me sing.
Hey, Will, because of the time, because we want to cover Darryl's album.
You know what? Yeah. We're going to need it. You know what?
I
the Power Hour concept is over. We're going to go into Power.
I want to know how you got into
We need 2 hours.
I want to know how you got into contemporary
jazz.
Violet,
we tried to do an hour with Darryl
Williams. And wound up being the sideman to the Stars, and then your first well, let's see. How many? Is this your third album? Or
it's my second.
Second album. Mm-hmm. Okay. How? Then let's go into your second album. Okay.
Jack, we're not doing the Power Hour anymore. We're doing the 2-hour Power Hour with Darryl Williams.
I haven't even scratched the surface with this.
Okay, I remember when I was, I think I was 16, 15 or 16 years old, and a friend of mine who I was, you know, I was learning from as well on the bass, named Dean Carter, okay? He was a great bass player in San Diego. He pulled up in my mom's front yard, and I heard this insane bass playing. And I said, "Who is that?" And he said, he looked at me like, he said, that's Marcus Miller. And I'm like, well, who's
And
Marcus
you're an
Miller?
R&B guy at that time, right?
I was, yeah, strictly R&B. So I, you know, at that point, he made me a recording of a bunch of Marcus Miller stuff.
Now, did the tone of his instrument grab you?
It was
the
sound. It was the
sound. Just roars.
It was
at
the
you.
Sound and the feel.
Yeah.
You know, the feel, and he was just so accurate and very musical. You know, wow. So I, you know, I just loved his playing at that time. So I really listened to Marcus. All the, you know, all the Luther Vandross stuff, and that's when I started. I'm realizing, man, this guy plays with, he's on all kind of records. Because I, you know, all the
Jamaica
Luther Vandross
Boys.
Stuff, right, the Jamaica Ooh. Boys, you know, he was on a lot of records.
That's what grabbed me this morning when the beauty of the show is we get to listen not for work but for pleasure as well. And mm-hmm. the sound of your instrument is almost like a horn to me. A lot of your grace notes.
That's the piccolo bass. You mean yeah. the piccolo You're stuff?
Darryl will talk, and yeah. I were talking about
it's
this
like
before
a horn player,
the
just the
show. Now, Darryl's new
it.
Album, Here to Stay,
great
which
album.
We're going to focus great. On the rest of the show now. Here to Stay, your first album came out, was it 10 years ago, Darryl?
2007.
Well, 11 years now, well, almost 11 years.
Okay.
Yeah, 2007.
That album, what was the name of it?
It was called That Was Then.
What does that mean?
It means, okay.
No, because I
that was
I
then. What do you normally say after that was then?
And there is now.
This is now, yeah. right? That was then. So I was inspired by.
Did some dues paying?
Yeah,
I love.
And
that.
By the way, that album has so many beautiful melodic songs. Oh. Costa Rica, oh, Time,
I freaking love
Goodbye,
it.
Mm-hmm. And that got a lot of play on Sirius Satellite Radio, right?
Right.
Even to this day.
And Music yep. Choice.
Yeah.
It's still on Music Choice.
Yeah.
You know, it's not really on XM now, but it's still on Music Choice.
And then again, Darryl's going around, and he's the go-to guy, and really has no time. I don't even know how you got out a second album. I really don't, because he's so good, and everybody wants him to play with him. He doesn't have time to really record an album.
He has a USB drive in his head. That's how he does it.
This is a typical meeting with Darryl. You got to hear my new song, man. It's yeah, killer. It's yeah. killer.
Oh,
you
yeah,
have
yeah,
his phone.
Yeah, I know.
I've
That's I know. And that's I'm true. That's
I'm,
true.
I'm listening true. To every song. Mm-hmm. Man, this is killer.
Oh, I know.
Why,
me
is,
too,
the,
me
why
too.
Is this not on the radio?
We were on that trip to Sacramento with Aisha, and I was hearing every song he was playing. And I was like, wow, every song was a
every,
hit.
Every song is a freaking number one
yeah,
hit.
Yeah.
I am not kidding.
We played at Humphrey's one night super late. We played hard. It was mm-hmm. sweaty in the backstage. Mm-hmm. And these guys just killed it. And he still had the energy at 11:15 to go, dude. Listen, come here. This is with a huge groove. Listen, and it's like, dude, we just got off. We just sweated, and you're like, it's a huge groove.
You gotta hear this.
It was so
okay.
Good.
So right now, I'm gonna play a song from Here to Stay, mm-hmm. and this is not a single. How long has it been?
Right.
Yeah, Darryl, this song is killing.
It's my dad's favorite.
Now, Grammy Award winner, Jeff Lorber's
yes,
on this track.
God bless you.
And of course, my good mm-hmm. friend, incredible. Saxophonist Mr. Marcus Anderson is awesome.
Marcus is amazing yeah. on this song.
Oh, and UNAM is on guitar.
Oh, really?
This
great UNAM, yeah.
This song is fantastic. And this is not even one of his singles. That's I'm like, cool. dude, why isn't this a single?
I know.
Can't you release three at one time, Darryl?
No.
No, economically not. Okay, so here we go. Thank you.
Great song.
Darryl, I have a confession to make. I probably listened to that song 1,000 times between last night and today. Well, what a beautiful song.
Thank you.
So Darryl has a his first single from the album was Here to Stay.
Right.
And that featured Huge Groove, right?
Yes, my very good friend, the incredible Huge Groove. Now, he mixed the record as well.
How did it feel to hit the Billboard charts with that?
It felt great, man.
Yeah, to our audience, Billboard magazine has charts for contemporary jazz, and it's hard to get on there.
It is.
There's a lot of great music out there right now, and everybody, as Will says, is in it to win it. Yeah. And a lot of Darryl's contemporaries are coming out with great music and being successful. Adam Holly. Yeah. Eric Valentine.
EV.
Yeah. Right. And
EV
this
is
guy,
incredible.
This guy had a Billboard top 10, and it's very prestigious even to be on the chart, let alone make top 10. So kudos to you, Darryl.
Thank you.
Right out of the box. Here
Very
to stay.
Well deserved.
Billboard top 10. And his current single, which he's going to play at the end of the show, Do You Remember, features Michael Langton, right?
Right.
Yeah, and that song.
I thought Darryl, I thought we had a deal till I finished my career and I'm at the La Quinta Senior Center. There would be no more singles.
So Darryl.
Let me tell you the single, the musicians on that.
Okay.
Tony Moore on drums. Kenneth Crouch on keys.
Ouch.
He played the keys on Thanksgiving morning. He spent the night over my house.
He's been out to your jam a few times too, right?
Yeah. He spent the night over my house. Okay, so we got up. We were just, you know, talking about music and stuff. And he said, man, you know, I'll play in something for you right now. And I said, well, I do have one song I want you to play on, but, you know, it's I don't think it's ready for you to play on it yet. He said, okay, well, let me just hear it. So I let him hear it.
Which one was this, Darryl?
This one right here. Do You Remember?
Killer.
Yeah. Okay, so he says, man, I'll play on it. And I said, yeah, it's not really ready. Well, okay, just for fun then. Just for fun. I said, okay.
Mm-hmm.
And he killed. It really, he brought the song to another level. He really did.
So, Darryl, one thing I'd like you to explain.
Oh. Let me not leave out Adam Holly's on guitar, okay, too, as well. I didn't want to leave that out. The great Adam Holly.
Great guest.
And mind you, this is like a third song, not counting his current single and his hit single. Mm-hmm. And that song's destined to be a hit as well, too, if it makes it to radio. So, Darryl, we were talking about this before. Now, everybody, you're accustomed to going to gigs, seeing the bass man behind.
Right.
And then you hear that low, deep bass.
Right.
Supportive.
Now, when you're a front man or you're playing the melody, you want a different pitch to your tone. You want to be a little higher up, right?
Right.
More like a guitar sound.
Exactly.
So can you explain what you do when you're playing the lead on a recorded song like on this album?
Okay, well, you know, all the lead on my record was on a 4-string bass guitar, but it was strung with piccolo strings are like an octave higher, you know, than a bass guitar. Actually, it may be even higher than that, because if you listen, it's almost like a guitar sound. So it's a piccolo bass.
Wow.
But it's actually a bass guitar with piccolo strings. So
they're going for more of a guitar type sound
to a guitar,
to play the lead rather than produce the bottom end.
Well, I remember a long time ago, the first album is all regular bass.
Really?
Even all the melodies, just regular bass. And I remember somebody told me one time, the closer it sounds to a guitar, the more pleasing it is to the average listener. If they don't know.
Interesting. Mm.
If they don't know and they just hear it. If they don't know if, you know, it's a guitar or a bass guitar, you know, it's just more pleasing to the ear.
So when you listen to Darryl's tunes, you'll hear a regular bass in the background as well.
Yes.
And Darryl was telling me that his show, he has a regular bass player
right.
when he's the front man.
Mm-hmm. It was Dwayne Smitty Smith at the last show. He killed it.
One of my goodness.
My favorite bass players. He's another one.
I was just going to ask you who you like to call.
Yeah, I love Smitty.
Darryl, we need to get you up front way more.
Darryl Williams is a great entertainer. I've done some package shows, and it just...
You need to get this music out there, because this is as good as anything there is out on the radio today, if not better.
Thank you. And
I hope that people realize that here.
And the showmanship at his shows, the song selection is a full arc of entertainment. And, you know, I know we were talking about you on the way up. It's so tough that you've got this catalog of material and you could do a show on a moment's notice, but then huge calls. What a treat. You've got A-listers calling you, and you're like, well, I still just wanted to be the front guy. All right, I'll do your gig. It's like, all right, I'll do your gig. So it's you know, it's a good problem to have. Mm-hmm. But I saw this beautiful woman over here shaking. Darryl Williams in the middle. That is an entree.
Darryl,
full meal.
Tell us about the making of this album. Now you have your own home studio.
Yes.
Yeah, so tell us how you made this album.
Well, I started writing songs for the record in 2007, and I had just started playing with Huge Groove in, like, at the end of 2007. I started writing songs, and I think the first song I wrote was probably "Harvest and Way." Right? Mm-hmm. I'm talking to my wife over there. I think "Harvest and Way" I think was the first song I wrote at that time. And a year later, maybe 6 months later, I asked Huge to play on it, and he said, "Okay, yeah." He played on it. And so, long story short, okay, I've been writing songs, and I've been probably 90% finished with that record 4 years ago, maybe 5 years ago, and I just couldn't get past the finish line. Okay, so a couple years ago, Huge says to me, "Man, do you realize I've done 4 records, and you working on the same record?" So I was like, man.
But you know, Darryl,
it's understandable. It's
understandable.
Yeah, but I basically forced myself to make it happen, because, you know, you always wait for motivation. Like, wow, you know, I need to be motivated to play
melodies. What was your motivation?
Trying to finish at that point, just trying to get the record finished. That was the motivation.
I've seen Darryl before a Catalina show. Just, I knew he had data in his brain. I'm thinking, what kind of computer software is that man running? It's amazing.
Yeah, I had a few people giving me a hard time about it. You know, Adam Gate was giving me a hard time. Greg was like, "Man, you're still working on the same record? Wow." You know,
and of course,
my wife was really giving me a hard time. You know, enough with the excuses, basically. You need to just finish it. So, you know what?
We're glad you did, because we can't hear it if you don't get it out.
So, Huge helped produce the album as well, too?
Yes, I was pretty much... done with the record, close to done with the record. He mixed the whole record, and I changed some things. We worked on some other things within the album, changed a couple things. So he was really instrumental in the sound of the record. I mean,
sound of the record. It's spectacular.
Mm-hmm. Sounds great.
So, yeah, he co-produced the record.
He's got great ears.
We have a minute left before Darryl plays live. Darryl, where can people get your music?
You can get the record on CD Baby, of course. You can get it on Amazon, or go to my website if you want a signed copy.
There you go.
That's the way to go right there.
And of course, you can hear it, you know, on iTunes, Spotify.
Darryl, please come out front more. Yeah. We need you out front. Yeah.
We
but,
need you.
But one thing is, don't stand on any chairs.
Yep.
Okay, whatever you do.
That's the only rule. That's
okay,
the only
the
rule.
Story. Okay, the San Diego Jazz Festival.
By the way, LA this Collective. Is the consummate chair stand.
Yes, I am.
Yeah. Me watching Will Donato and Blake Aaron stand on chairs, I had some courage there. Mm-hmm. Okay. A number one, I was standing on a speaker.
This
right?
is the San Diego,
San Diego Jazz Festival. Last year.
Boney James, Brian Culbertson, everybody you can think of, and this guy.
I like that you did it, though. You went and did it.
I was playing with the LA Collective, right? You know, that's Adam, Greg Manning, Tony Moore, and Keith McKelly on sax.
Oh, good.
Okay,
people.
So Keith I McKelly. Jump off the stage, right? Which is cool. Yep. That's fine. I was okay.
We were embracing it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I didn't break anything, so I jumped off the stage.
I'll tell you about my right foot surgery. It's a dirty little secret. I have a fused big toe from jumping off stages. Oh, wow. That's okay.
I don't know what was going through my head. I saw this cheer, all these people around. I can see it in slow motion in my head right now.
Mm-hmm.
Let me get on the chair, you know, just to add some entertainment.
Yep.
I get on the chair, and I'm just going for it. And I feel the chair starting to waver, so I'm thinking, let me step on this next chair. And right as I'm lifting my foot, the chair collapsed.
And you know what? This guy kept playing.
Kept playing on the ground, just in there.
And they lifted me up while I was playing. They were lifting me up off the ground.
But if you want to be here to stay, don't be doing that anymore.
Nah, I'm done with
it. Okay, so right now, Daryl's going to take us out. Darryl Williams, woo! Thank you for being you.
Thank you.
Thank you for being the great musician, mentor.
What a treat.
And all you do for the music community.
We appreciate
you. And Darryl's going to take us home with?
A live performance.
This is called Do You Remember. This is the current single right now.
Yeah, go out and get this single, get this
Darryl
album.
Darryl Williams, folks.
Enjoy. We'll see you in a couple weeks.
Williams, folks. That is how you do it.
It's Michael Lincoln on alto.
I knew that was Michael. Awesome. I love that sound.
Okay, everybody. Have a great weekend, and catch Darryl tonight at the Catalina Club.
With Kim Waters.
Also, Nils wanted to say shout out to him at Spaghettini tonight. So there's two shows going on.
Nils Jipner.
And Richard Edwards just said hi. He just tuned in to see this nice man right here. Richard Edwards, we love you. And
we'll see you back here again on the 17th. And please, you know, tune in. Love to have you watch our show.
Big thank you to Darryl Williams, delivering stellar artistry. Didn't have enough time to even scratch the surface, but we did some scratching.
Hey, thank you guys for having me.
What a treat.
Honor. Come down.
We're going to get to the bottom of this bio in the next two shows with Darryl Williams. Okay. Part two. This is part one.
Power hour.
Part one.
There you go.
Killed it. God.
It's Inside the Music with saxophonist Will Donato and co-host Jack Cohen. We bring you renowned recording artists and musical guests from around the globe, featuring live in-studio performances from our very special guests. We broadcast live from the LA Talk Radio studios the first and third Saturdays of each month in stunning HD video. Thank you for tuning in to Inside the Music.